I think that's the real power of an ID. I have everything there. I can stay in the context of my app, debug, profile, test. Everything is right there at my fingertips, and I'm productive immediately.
Hi, I'm Richard Campbell, and I do .NET Rocks and Run As Radio. I'm here down at the Microsoft campus to do a mini-series about Visual Studio, and I'm starting out with my friends Mads Kristensen, who you've worked in studio a long time. It's the early aughts, I think.
Yeah, it's been like 25 years, I think, by now.
25 years, so you're almost as long as studio's been around. Like, I was a 97 user in VB before that.
Yeah,
so
that's how I started, too.
Carried through. Yep. I guess you were a VB guy also.
Uh-huh. VB, and one of the first things I did write in Visual Studio, mm-hmm. and my first Visual Studio was the academic edition.
Right, because you were in school.
I was in school at the time, or I think I was actually just finishing up school, but I still qualified. The first thing I built was a Windows mobile application. So not Windows Phone.
No.
That came much later.
That's later.
This was back when there was pocket PCs, there were PDAs.
Yeah, yeah.
There was Windows mobile.
Right.
And I actually wrote an app that talked over a SOAP service, I think, to a back-end API. Also,
compact framework?
It was compact framework, yeah.
Think of all the different flavors we've had along the years. It's been a long time.
It has.
But, I mean, studio has always been a part of it. Yep. Most people know you as the extensions guy. I mean, that's certainly what we've talked about on .NET Rocks over the years, is you're the guy who I think has the most extensions.
Yeah, I think it's closing in on 200.
That's too many.
And I was looking at this the other day, actually, and the first extension I wrote is almost 12 years ago. So I've been doing this for quite a while.
And there was this dynamic where some of these extensions ended up in the product, so they stopped being extensions?
Now that, you know, I sit and build features into Visual Studio,
right.
And sometimes good ideas come from extensions. They come from all over the place, right? And sometimes an idea is so good that we want to build it into Visual Studio because we realize that this is going to help the majority of our users.
Right.
We sometimes experiment with extensions. We say, maybe people would like a feature like this. Let's try it out. Let's see.
So try it as an extension.
Yeah.
See how many downloads you get, how many people are using it.
Well, and nowadays with things being open source and GitHub and all those things, we invite people to open bugs on GitHub and even send us pull requests.
Yeah.
And so we actually
make contributions to it.
Yes.
I mean, that's a great line.
Because then we get that sort of iteration, and a lot of stuff can happen in 1 month. Mm-hmm. So we do some of these experiments and we just run them for 1 month. And we get iterations over iterations, publish out new versions as we refine the ideas and the designs with the community along the way. And they end up in the product. And we do this every month. I think we have, in the latest version of Visual Studio, I think we have two or three features that came in from extensions and from experimentation with the community. So it's very exciting.
Well, it also hints this idea of if I build a great extension, maybe it'll be part of the product someday.
That could happen. It's happened many times. And when that happens, we always make sure to work with the extension author to build it in. Oftentimes we see when we have extensions coming in and becoming popular, they usually start because they fill a niche that Visual Studio hasn't filled yet. Or it's kind of it's an edge case. It doesn't apply to maybe the majority of people. But, you know, things change.
Sure.
The world evolves, and sometimes they become more important.
What used to be a niche feature becomes a central feature.
Yeah, exactly.
And I mean, this is the whole point of an IDE, right? Is that everything you're likely to need is right there in the window at your fingertips.
Yep, exactly. And I think that's the real power of an IDE. Mm-hmm. And that's why I love an IDE, is that I have everything there. I can stay in the context of my app, work on my app, debug, profile, test. And everything is right there at my fingertips. Mm-hmm. I don't have to go out and install different things and different apps and different extensions or anything like that. It's all there from the beginning, and I'm productive immediately.
Yeah. The challenge for a lot of folks then is there's so much stuff. Like sometimes you try to figure out which pieces you want to use. Like I got to think people's configurations are very personal, how they get it set the way they want to set it up.
Yes. We have a lot of interesting findings from when we invite people into our labs and we measure their eye movements, we see how they use Visual Studio.
Interesting.
And we give them tasks. Like one that I found really interesting was we asked people to compile their solution.
Right.
Because how many different ways is there to compile the solution?
I'm pretty sure it's one. It's F5.
Yeah. So there's F5. That's one, right? Control Shift B, use a keyboard shortcut. That's another.
Okay.
Some people would right-click the solution
on the Solution Explorer
and
build.
And then hit Build Solution.
Right.
And the one that really took me by surprise was that some people go to the top level menu,
right,
and go down and click to build the solution.
There you go.
I would never in a million years have thought about it doing it that way. But it talks about just how different people are, how different they work. And that's just how to use like the feature that we all use, because that's kind of part of building an app to compile,
absolutely,
right? So imagine you have mobile development, web development, API development, game development, and all these other scenarios, just the matrix of different ways of working, different types of apps you're building. It's like there is no common ways of doing things. It's
right.
All very, very different, and we have to cater to all of it.
Well, I guess that's part of the challenge of building a product like that is mm-hmm. there's many different kinds of developers.
Yes.
And there's many, and they change too. You know, yeah. You started out as a web developer and you move over to mobile development, or you get into doing desktop and same tool.
Yeah.
Same languages often too.
And it's just, it's not just that you move from one thing to another, mm-hmm. you overlap.
Yeah, you never get to just stop yeah. and then move.
So you have developers that does C++, and C Sharp, they mm-hmm. do sometimes web, sometimes they maintain old legacy systems
sure.
as well, and they can do everything from within Visual Studio.
Yeah, very powerful.
They don't have to leave. Way. What we do see is that people, sometimes they would have many versions of Visual Studio open at the same time.
True. But
they can do all within the same tools, right? They can mm-hmm. reuse their skills, they don't have to relearn everything.
Well, when did I learn F5? 30 years ago?
Right.
Really? I mean, Visual Studio has been around a long time, and I've seen extremely large organizations depend on it, big enterprise operations. How different is that from just the two of us working on a project or something? Like, what does it look like to do enterprise-type development with Visual Studio?
Well, I think that's as different as there are many different enterprises, and
sure.
everyone does it differently, but I think there are some commonalities. You know, if I was to just build an app in my own home, just a private individual, I don't really need that much stuff, right? Mm-hmm. I need to be able to run and compile and publish
sure.
to the cloud somewhere, and that's it. But typically when we're talking about, you know, enterprise software, we have a bunch of other things that are really important, such as mm-hmm. accessibility, security, governance, a whole bunch of things, continuous delivery and integration
yeah.
and so on, right? Test suites. So many more things are part of the software process. And so when I think enterprise and the enterprise grade software development, mm-hmm. it includes all that.
Right.
So it's not just writing the code, it's everything on top of that as well. And
the
it's very, very important.
Standards, look and feel. I mean,
yeah,
when
standards.
I deal with enterprises mm-hmm. working in this space, it's literally hundreds of apps inside of the company.
Yes.
Like it's a lot.
Yes.
You maintain a portfolio
mm-hmm.
and people move around on them too. So,
yep.
you know, you want those kinds of standards so that people stay productive no matter what they work on.
Yep.
I mean, I've had this experience where mm-hmm. you can't just compile. It's now sort of grading your code. It's doing a code review before the code review.
Yes, it's all those things. And it, you know, we call it shifting left,
right?
Which means things that was maybe an afterthought before.
Mm-hmm.
It used to be something like, let's say, accessibility.
Right.
What tools can we provide inside Visual Studio that fits within your flow, like your inner loop,
right.
your develop, test, debug loop, and we can move that into that so that it happens automatically. It is no longer an afterthought.
You're not trying to retrofit accessibility into the app, but you
right.
build it as you go.
You build it as you go.
Instead of that big friction at the end, mm-hmm. a little friction along the way, and then it just flows.
And the tool helps you.
Mm-hmm.
So if we do it right, it's almost frictionless.
I like that.
So that's where we want to be. And that's a wonderful grow-up story, right? We have the individual developer, but mm-hmm. you know, as more and more things is added on top, it's a seamless experience to integrate these different things and shift them left into your development workflow.
Right.
And it happens all within the IDE. And that's really the power of having an IDE. That context is all there.
Right. So you're there the whole time.
Yep.
And I mean, anybody can now add these capabilities and then have the tool help them navigate them to be successful with them.
Yep.
Powerful. Exactly. And I think about the Microsoft ecosystem as a whole. I mean, most people don't use Visual Studio in a bubble. You've probably got M365. You've probably got Azure accounts. Studio's good at all of that.
Yeah. We see from all the different teams within Microsoft mm-hmm. how they extend Visual Studio so that we as developers can take advantage of all those different services from the cloud and Windows and all over Teams. If you mm-hmm. want to write a Teams extension, you can do that.
Even the Open API,
Open
AI APIs now are available.
Absolutely, and they're easily to consume or easy to consume from within
yeah.
Visual Studio. And you know, all the way from writing code against these different services to your, you know, getting your continuous integration up on GitHub and publishing to Azure and so on and so forth, when you stay within the Microsoft ecosystem and work with all these different features, being in Visual Studio is the prime location for that, right? Yeah. Because you get it all from within there. You can reuse your skills, your muscle memory. It's all familiar and you're productive out of the gate.
Just another piece to bring in and then run with.
Yes.
So where can we point people? I mean, obviously this is a whole series of videos we're going to be making together with a bunch of different people. They're going to come out over time. But I also want to give people opportunities to try things, to take stuff out for a spin. I mean, you're the extension god. Where do you point people to sort of, if you've never played with an extension, what should you try?
Well, that's a kind of a really interesting rabbit hole because once you look at what's available, and there's thousands of extensions, a whole world opens up.
Yeah.
And we do know a lot of people, they have a hard time like setting time aside to look at the marketplace. We call it the marketplace.
Yep.
Even though most things are free.
Mm-hmm. Best kind of marketplace.
Yes. There's just so many things there. And you wouldn't even believe some of the niche, esoteric, specialized extensions are out there just for very specific scenarios. You might have one of those scenarios that would be helped by one of these extensions. So
that's very powerful.
It's really cool. So I would go to the top level menu in Visual Studio. There's one called Extensions.
Yeah.
And click the Extension Manager button and start searching and see what's in there.
See what you're finding. You're going to find some of Mads' stuff for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Mads, I'm super excited about this series. We got a lot to talk about over the next few hours, and we'll see what we get.
Yep.
So thanks so much for being part of this. Enjoy the mini series. There's more to come.